This is NPR's All Things Considered. I'm Robert Siegel. This year, we're celebrating the best American music of the 20th century, music of all genres that changed the way we listen. Every Monday, we present a selection from the NPR 100. Today, we celebrate a piece of music that became so popular, so widely played for so long, that it's hard to imagine how fresh it sounded early in the century. As NPR's Susan Stamberg reports, it was the revolutionary tune that launched the phenomenon known as American popular song.
In 1911, the new books were The Secret Garden by Frances Hodgson Burnett and Ethan Frome by Edith Wharton. The new songs were Oh You Beautiful Doll, I Want a Girl Just Like the Girl Who Married Dear Old Dad, If You Talk in Your Sleep, Don't Mention My Name, and this one, the biggest hit of them all. Alexander's Ragtime Band by 23-year-old Irving Berlin. The musical sensation of the decade, Variety raved. A public menace, according to a clipping in Berlin's scrapbook. The theme song of a generation, his daughter Mary Ellen writes. All these roses and brickbats for a tune which Berlin's biographer Laurence Bergreen says was passé by the time it was written.
In fact, the ragtime craze had already swept the country several years earlier and had played itself out.
But there was something about this song that set toes tapping. In those days, before radio or TV, families and friends gathered around the piano and sang. Their music was printed on sheets of paper that sold for 5 or 10 cents. Stores like Woolworth's kept 1,000 different song titles in stock, and a truly popular song, like Alexander's Ragtime Band, made cash registers sing. It sold 1.5 million copies of sheet music in its first year and a half, a true phenomenon. It was so popular, they played it on the Titanic. The fellow who wrote this song had had some mini hits by 1911, little ditties like My Wife Has Gone to the Country, Hurrah, Hurrah. Biographer Laurence Bergreen says Irving Berlin was pitching songs to various Broadway reviews.
Keep in mind that he was writing at this point in his life, and he was very young, 4 or 5 songs a day, or I should say 4 or 5 songs a night, because even then he was an insomniac, and so he would stay up all night writing songs. Until he said, drops of sweat were pouring from his forehead and plopping onto the paper in front of him.
Well, that's a bit of perspiration misrepresentation, Bergreen admits, because Irving Berlin, probably the greatest all-around songwriter this country has ever had, couldn't read or write music. With no formal training, Berlin always hired a musical secretary to set his melodies down on the paper he sweated on. Other phenom oddities about Berlin, he could play the piano, but only the black keys, and only in one key, F sharp. He had his pianos fitted with a special lever that acted the way a capo does on a guitar. He shifted the lever to change the key. He called it his Buick. The Smithsonian in Washington has one of Berlin's pianos. Oh, right, back to the song that made Irving Berlin. There were rumors that Berlin didn't write Alexander's Ragtime.
There, because of his propensity to use musical secretaries, he was dogged by rumors his entire life that he hired ghostwriters, and they wrote tunes for him anonymously. Not true. You know, there's just no substance to those rumors, which were a good story and kind of promoted by his many jealous Tin Pan Alley rivals.
Berlin wrote it first as an instrumental. When the tune alone didn't do much, he went back and wrote lyrics. The song got into a Broadway review, which closed quickly, not a propitious beginning. But Alexander's Ragtime Band began catching on outside New York, thanks to hard-working song pluggers. Then, back in New York, Al Jolson, America's first superstar, sang it, and the song went to hit heaven.
Come on in here, Alexander's Ragtime Band.
This is Jolson years later on a 1938 radio tribute to Bergreen.
You can play a bugle call like you never heard before. So natural that you want to go to war. That's just the bestest band, what am. Oh, honey lamb, come on along.
Honey lamb, come on along. I'm all alone. Let me take you by the hand. Up to the man, up to the man. Who is the leader of the band?
Bessie Smith, the great blues singer, recorded Alexander's Ragtime Band in 1927. Her interpretation is earnest and sincere, a Smithsonian liner note says, as if there actually were an Alexander's Ragtime Band, and she were one of its true proponents.
It's the best band in the land. Listen to the bugle call.
Well, there was not a real Alexander's Ragtime Band. There wasn't even a real Alexander. Laurence Bergreen says Irving Berlin was simply echoing a well-known genre song of the day.
The Alexander song, which is taps into a very tragic, sad part of our nation's racial history, because an Alexander song was a type of song that was meant to refer to black vaudeville, often in a disparaging way. Alexander was thought to be a comically grand name for a black vaudeville actor to take.
In those politically incorrect early years of the 20th century, a song like Alexander's Ragtime Band was known as a coon song, disparaging to blacks, funny to whites, performed by singers of both races. There were lots of songs like it then, full of ethnic barbs, songs that made stereotypic fun of all of America's immigrants, the Irish, Germans, Jews. Irving Berlin, a cantor's son, also wrote a song called Cohen Owes Me $97. It was the music, the sentiment in the air then. Not only was there no real Alexander, Alexander's Ragtime Band was not a real rag. Pianist Virginia Eskin, a ragtime expert, says ragtime is in two, and it's a slow two. If Berlin's tune were a real rag, it would sound like this.
All over the place, because a rag is all over the place musically.
Virginia Eskin says rags move around harmonically in every bar, whereas Berlin's music is very simple.
It stays in F major again, and then goes to C7th and back to F. So anybody could remember that, and songs that become very popular are very simplistic.
Simple, not many notes, lots of what composer Alec Wilder called open spots. And those notes are put together to form not a rag, but a march. However, Virginia Eskin says Berlin's march does have some ragtime elements and two cute other elements.
First, there is the syncopation, because a real rag is a march in the left hand, and the right hand is ragged or syncopated. And Irving Berlin does syncopate the melody, because it's... And if it were straight, it would be. But it's herky-jerky. And then he also adds a very clever thing after eight bars, which I never really paid attention to. The words say he can play a bugle call like you never heard before. And what does Berlin cleverly do? He sticks in reveille. Which is, it's what the, you know, you wake up to every morning in the military. So he's lifted that right out of sort of American consciousness. And then a few bars later, he sticks in another sort of quote from Swanee River, which is a Stephen Foster slow song. But Irving Berlin puts it in the march up-tempo and sort of, you know, jerks it along.
And and voila, an English-influenced bugle-saluting ragged march that becomes the first American mega-hit. Popular not just in this country, but in Europe, too, especially in England, where Alexander's Ragtime Band was second in popularity only to God Save the King. Europe saw this as quintessentially American music, with a flavor, a syncopation, a sunny sound that dazzled the old world. And the lyrics were relaxed, informal, they echoed colloquial speech. Irving Berlin, who became immediately known as the Ragtime King, didn't set out to help invent American popular music. All he wanted to do was write hits, and he did. Even though biographer Laurence Bergreen says Berlin could have rested on his ragtime.
I think if he had never written another song after 1911, he would have always been remembered as that young composer who wrote the unforgettable all-American Alexander's Ragtime Band.
Happily for the world, Irving Berlin wrote thousands of songs after Alexander. By the time he died in 1989, at the age of 101, Irving Berlin had produced most of America's popular anthems.
You don't know where to go to. Why don't you go where fashion sits? Put no lights.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
From the mountain to the prairie, to the ocean wide with foam, God bless
and I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
I'm Susan Stamberg, NPR News, Washington.